In this example, I'm going to be doing a hypothesis test for the mean when sigma is known. And I want to do an example of a two-tailed test using the critical value method, the method where we find our standardized test statistic and compare it to a critical value or values, depending on whether or not you have a one-tailed or a two-tailed test. In this problem, it says a fast food restaurant estimates that the mean sodium content in one of its breakfast sandwiches is 920 milligrams. A random sample of 44 breakfast sandwiches has a mean sodium content of 925 milligrams. Assume the population standard deviation, sigma, is 18 milligrams. At alpha equal 0.10, do you have enough evidence to reject the restaurant's claim? So the first thing you want to do is you want to read the problem carefully and identify the claim as stated or implied in the problem and write it in terms of a mathematical statement using the correct population parameter. So right here we have a clue. The parameter being tested is mu because this is a claim about a mean, and even though it doesn't say claim, it says here a fast food restaurant estimates, it's implied that this is the claim. So it says here the mean sodium content is 920 milligrams. Okay, so writing that as a mathematical statement in terms of the parameter, it's going to be mu equal 920. Okay, so this is the claim. Now you need to structure the null and the alternative around that. If the claim contains the case of equality, then it's the null hypothesis. Otherwise, it's the alternative. So you'll see here that this contains the case of equality. It is equality. So this makes this statement the null. So it forces the alternative to be not equal to 920. Okay, so no direction is implied or inequality is implied in this problem. So just to put down what we're given, going back to the problem, we have a sample size of 44, and from that sample, we got a mean sodium content of 925. So this means that X bar, that's what we're given in the problem, X bar is 925, okay? Our sample size is 44. And in this problem, we're told to assume that the population standard deviation is 18 milligrams. So we know from probably a prior study that sigma is equal to 18. All right, when sigma is known, we're going to use a z-score to standardize our test statistic. Our test statistic from the sample in raw form is X bar, but we need to standardize this or convert it to a z-score so we can compare it to our two critical values. Okay, because we have a not equals in the alternative, this is going to be a two-tailed test, and I'm going to have two areas of rejection. All right, so to find our standardized test statistic, I'm going to use this formula, and I always like to put a little asterisk for my test statistic because our critical values are also going to be z-scores, and I like to just differentiate between the test statistic and a critical value. You don't have to do this, it's just something that I've done since I was in college. All right, so the test statistic formula is X bar, what we observe from the sample, minus what is claimed in the hypotheses. Is this difference statistically significant enough to reject the null? To know for sure at our given level of significance, we want to standardize, so we need to divide by some sort of standard deviation here. Because we're talking about the sampling distribution of X bar, the central limit theorem gives us this denominator. It's sigma over the square root of n. Okay, and we know sigma because we assumed it in the problem, and we know 44. So plugging all of the information in, I have 925 minus 920 over 18 over the square root of 44. All right, so we do have a difference between what we observe and what is claimed, but we don't know if this difference is enough to warrant rejecting the null. So putting this information into the calculator, and I lost my calculator, here it is, and I strongly suggest using parentheses around the numerator and the denominator possibly, just so the calculator observes the correct order of operations. Now I could certainly do that subtraction in the numerator easily, but I wanted to show you how you could put this in all in one step. Okay, divided by 18 divided by square root 44. Okay, so I'm going to get a z-score from this. Rounding to two decimal places, I get a z-score of 1.84. So this means that what we observe from our sample is 1.84 standard deviations away from the mean. Now, is this enough to reject the null hypothesis? Well, we need to use our level of significance to answer that. So we need to find the two critical values based on alpha. Now, I have two critical values because this is a two-tailed test. And to find those, I need to use our given level of significance. Okay, this is a common one. All right. How we find our critical values is the same way for a two-tailed test as how we found them using confidence intervals. Okay, so I want to draw the standard normal distribution because I'm working with the z-distribution. And I want to shade my two areas of rejection. And I have 0.9 amount of area between my two critical values. Because alpha is 0.1, I'll have 0.9 between the two areas of rejection. Now, when you have a two-tailed test, you need to divide the level of significance in half. So in other words, I'll have 0.05 amount of area in this upper tail and 0.05 area in this lower tail. Now, recall from the chapter on confidence intervals, when you're given an area first and working backwards to find a z-score, you want to use your inverse normal function. Now, this is a common level of confidence. This is a common level of confidence. So you could use that quick table in your book that lists critical values for common levels of confidence. Okay, if our level of significance is 0.1, our level of confidence would be 0.9. Or just to review, you could use your inverse normal distribution. Now remember, your inverse normal distribution, going to my distribution menu, expects a cumulative area. So I can get this lower tail first. My cumulative area up to this lower critical value, okay, right here, this is the mystery critical value that we're looking for. Okay, it's going to be negative because it's below zero. I'm gonna select my inverse normal distribution because I'm working with standard normal. And I want this to be my left tail. And rounding to three decimal places, this is going to be 1.645. Now, if you have a newer TI-84, you might have noticed in that inverse normal menu, there was the center option. You could have put in 0.9. That's the amount of area that's symmetric about zero, and it would have outputted the two critical values. Okay. Now that I found the lower critical value, by symmetry, the upper critical value is going to be positive 1.645. All right, so our two critical values are plus or minus 1.645. Here is our standardized test statistic. This is a real number line. Smaller numbers are further to the left, larger numbers are further to the right. Where is this number placed on this number line? Is it in between our two critical values? If it is, this is the fail to reject region, and we would be in favor of the null. In other words, we would fail to reject the null. If our test statistic is out in either of these tails, then we would reject the null. Now, I hope it's obvious to you that 1.84 is greater than 1.645. So it's out here in this tail. So my test statistic is out here in my rejection region. So I know what my decision is. My decision is to fail to reject the null. My decision is to reject the null because I am out in this rejection area. I am further to the right of this critical value. I am rejecting the null. So to make it easier, you could circle the hypothesis that the decision represents. And notice, I did not circle the claim. I am rejecting the null. The null is the claim. I am in favor of the alternative. So to answer the question, do you have enough evidence to reject the restaurant's claim? The claim is the null, and we are rejecting the null. So yes, there is sufficient evidence, if I can spell that right, be a miracle. There is sufficient evidence to reject the restaurant's claim that their sandwiches, I think this is about sandwiches, their sandwiches mean sodium content is 920 milligrams. Okay, so we are rejecting that claim, okay? Now for a two-tailed test, unless we're looking at a confidence interval, it's hard to tell if the mean sodium content is greater than this or less than 920. Okay, I'm thinking it's greater than 920, just where the standardized test statistic is placed. But the critical the confidence interval method also gives you a sense of what's going on with the population parameter. Now, because the null is rejected, it is possible a type 1 error may have occurred. Okay, a type 1 error is associated with rejecting the null. When you reject the null, it is possible a type 1 error may have occurred. We may have rejected the null when the null is really true. You cannot have a type 1 and a type 2 error at the same time because you cannot reject and fail to reject the null at the same time. So it's important to keep in mind that because we're basing our decisions on samples, it is possible an error may have occurred.